A man willing to do anything to numb his emotions.
I started doing ecstasy drugs, you know, taking 3-4 pills a day.
Finds a cure for his pain.
My right knee touched the altar floor. Bam! This heavy weight just got lifted off me.
On today's 700 Club Interactive.
On 700 Club Interactive, we use technology to pray for each other and explore topics that matter to you. Watch what God is doing in the world today.
Well, welcome to the show. America is called the Great Melting Pot. Immigrants have come from far and wide in search of a better life, education, and career.
Like the man in our first story, Bees Nachia was a young Cambodian immigrant living in San Francisco. However, after being abandoned by his father, Visna plunged into a life of darkness until a voice led him to the light.
I was born in 1979 in a Thailand refugee camp. I came to the States in the 1980s. My family was settled down in a townland of San Francisco in the inner city. My dad was the main supporter. He was the main protector. He was the main person that kept our family together. Time passed, his passion kind of dwindled away, his love for our family kind of dwindled away. He started to love his country more, Cambodia. One night, I remember this conversation with him and mom, just talking, but he just felt like, hey, you know what? I'm just gonna leave the family without explaining to any of us why he had to go. Next day, he disappeared. I was like 15 years old. My family became broken when he left. Everybody was just like going to uncles and aunts because my mom went a little crazy. She couldn't handle the stress. She became really dependent on alcohol. That's how everything started. That's how I just started joining the gang. That's how drugs came in. That's how, you know, the rave scene came in. It was just my time to explore, but we didn't explore in the right way because everything around us was negative. Marijuana was just more like a startup drug. And then, you know, I started doing ecstasy drugs, you know, taking 3-4 pills a day, you know? And then lacing the ecstasy, marijuana, all that kind of stuff. Crystal meth I did. But at 21, my life was so dark. Drugs didn't help. The scene that I'm around, the ladies didn't help. The alcohol didn't help. And then at one point, my mom came home when I was 21 and she was suffering. And I'm like, man, how can I help my mom? And me and my brother that night had in our conscience to kill her, just to help her end her misery. But I woke up with a conscience in my head like, hey, did you know last night you were this close killing your mom? I'm like, what? And that was my tipping point. Like, oh, heck no. You know, like, why the heck? In your mind, you're gonna kill your own mother. You know what I mean? That's how dark I went. So I went to this rave scene the next week, and I did all this drugs just to drown out my sorrow. And in the middle of this small mansion at Santa Rosa, I heard this voice in the back of my head. It says, go to church. Go to church? What do you mean, go to church? And throughout my whole night, like 2-3 more hours, this voice was grabbing me. It's like, go to church, you know? Broke up all my cousins, all my friends. Hey, get up, man. I need to go to San Francisco, cross the bay. I need to go back and go to church. People start laughing at me like, what the heck? My best friend said, you know what, all right, let's go. We got to the city at 40 minutes. We were hitting 110, flying, still smoking weed. We didn't care, you know, we're like, we just reckless. Opened this door, the intercessor goes, son, what did you want? I said, I'm here for church. I just sat down and man, behold, I just fell asleep. I heard some cymbals, some drums, ding bang, so I got up and it was the end of the service. It was like this pure high. I feel good. But what I was in the Holy Ghost presence. I didn't know. To my left is the exit. I thought I was walking, going to the left, and I end up in the altar. And I looked around like, what the heck? I'm in the front. Pastor Roger goes, we're gonna repent, we're gonna kneel, we're gonna go on our knees. He's preaching a salvation message. And around 5 to 6 people around me went on their knees. So, you know, I just did it. I just went on my knees, then my right knee touched the altar floor. Bam, this heavy weight just got lifted off me. Tears start dropping like a faucet been blown up, like, but it felt good. And then one of our chaplain came and he prophesied over me, put his hand on my shoulder and goes, "You're gonna be called to God's work, but you gotta lay down your life. If you serve the Lord, God will take care of your mom." So I look at bro like, what the heck? How the heck you know about my family issue, right? He goes, "Cause God told me." Boom! Went down, two knees now. I was like crying. They just let me cry. I got up and I saw this puddle of tears. I said, "What just happened?" Pastor goes, "You encountered the Lord." I go, "I want this. I want more of this. How do I do it?" I was so in awe of God's mercy and God's grace. I felt the identity who I was in Christ Jesus. I was filled with the Holy Spirit. It's been 13 years I've been solid. And because of all my trials and all my sorrow, I realized the grace he's given me, you know, is amazing. I can't repay him.
No, that's an amazing story, isn't it? Of how God just steps in and does something incredible in the life of a young man who was so filled with pain. And over again, as he talked about the drugs, he kept saying, "It felt good. It felt good." Boy, you don't know what good feels like till God gets a hold of you.
I love his honesty, his transparency, and just how he relates. The real power that comes when God gets a hold of you. The old things all pass away, and behold, all things become new. So regardless of where you are in life, realize God wants to come to you where you are. And whether you're Zacchaeus up in a tree, or a blind beggar by gate, or a demoniac wandering around the tombs, Jesus goes out of his way to travel to you to say to you, just as he said to Zacchaeus, "Today, I want to dine with you. I want to have a meal with you." And it's no ordinary meal. He wants to share of his divine nature so you can be full of the same glory you just saw. That was eyewitness testimony of what can happen and how all the hurts, all the pain, all the things you're trying to medicate away, all of that can be lost in the glory of him. He wants to share his righteousness with you. Christianity is a unique religion. It's not about how can we be good enough or how can we do enough good things or do the right rituals or all of that. It's just coming to him, falling on our knees and saying, "Lord, I surrender. I surrender to you. I surrender all. And I want you. This is real. And I want more of it." If you want that, if you want this experience, not just hear about it, watch it, wonder, but you can know for sure that there is a living God and he will come to you and be with you. And the amazing thing is he transforms you from your innermost being. So the things that you used to want to do no longer interest you. And you want to pursue him and have that relationship with him. If this is for you, just bow your head right now. Pray a very simple prayer and let God do all the rest. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, that's right, say it out loud. Jesus, I hear about you, I've read about you, and I want to know that you're real. So Jesus, you died for me, and I want you to be in my heart. I want you to forgive me, I want you to cleanse me, I want you to take away all my hurt and be my Savior. And Jesus, if you'll do this, if you set me free, if you take that weight off of me, I want to follow you all the days of my life. Hear my prayer, for I pray it in Jesus' name. Father, for those who just prayed, I ask for an outpouring of your love. I ask that your presence would come in them and be all around them, and that you would relieve them of all their burdens now. Let your love flow. Baptize them in your love. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. The Bible says that if you'll believe in your heart and then confess with your mouth, you shall be saved. What I want you to do is call somebody. Let them know that you believe, that you want to have Jesus in your heart. Number's toll free, 888-777-1999. When you call, I've got something I want you to have. It's called A New Day. And there's a CD teaching. What do Christians believe? What is Christianity all about? What do I do now? What are the next steps? So call, get it. It's all free. Phone call's free. I also encourage you to join a local church. It's in the fellowship of like-minded believers that we all grow in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So do that. But start with that phone call. Make it now. 888-777-1999. Well, coming up, a crippled girl walks for the first time after watching television. Her story is up next. A young girl struggling with Lyme disease refuses to give up hope.
I remember Mary Rose saying, "Oh, really? I'm 11 years old, and you're not going to tell me I'm not going to walk again? Obviously, you don't know my God."
How her faith proved greater than her prognosis on the next 700 Club Interactive.
In 2008, my husband Gary departed for heaven. I was still grieving. And then to find out I had cancer, I began praying, "God, how do I do this? Where do I do this?" Cancer Treatment Centers of America was the place. Dr. Neelam outlined a plan that would take care of my mind and my body, and she prayed with me.
For Bible-believing Christians, we're able to pray with them in a much deeper way as they begin to really rely upon their faith.
At Cancer Treatment Centers of America, we believe in the power of faith and prayer as indispensable allies in the fight against complex and advanced stage cancer.
I'm back in Telluride on the mountain skiing. I feel strong and healthy.
Advanced medicine and technology.
And I am a survivor.
The warm embrace of the spirit and the power of prayer.
These are happy tears.
Please go to cancercenter.com/faith. Appointments available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
In one Nigerian village, people gather in a pastor's home to watch the 700 Club. And during the show one day, they got to watch something even better, a crippled child taking her very first steps.
Aminat had always been a sickly child. Her mother, Aishat, worried about her constantly.
When she was a few months old, I noticed she didn't babble or gurgle like other babies. She only coughed. She never sat up or crawled like other children. I knew something was wrong and did everything I could to make her well.
She owned a small food stand but spent everything she had on herbalists and shamans. Her daughter never got better and couldn't walk. Soon, Aishat had no money and lost her shop. Neighbors like Khadijat helped whenever they could.
I knew how sick the child was. When times were especially bad for them, my family supported them financially.
One day, Aishat was talking to a friend who said her son was healed after watching the 700 Club at a pastor's house.
I did not believe that anything could come out of it at first, but after we started watching the 700 Club, I noticed Aminat's cough had stopped. That was the first miracle. My friend then encouraged me to believe in Jesus Christ.
Over the next few days, Aminat steadily got better and better. That made Aishat think a lot about God and her beliefs. She kept watching the 700 Club.
The first time we watched the program at home, I held Aminat on my lap. As the host prayed, she suddenly jumped up and began to walk around. I followed her around, wondering if this was real.
Aishat and Aminat found the pastor and gave their lives to Christ. When they got home, their friends and neighbors were shocked to see Aminat walking and asked what happened. That day, seven other Muslims, including Khadijat, gave their lives to Christ too.
When I gave my life to Christ, the change was tremendous. I began to see wonders in my life too.
And to help Aishat get back on her feet financially, Operation Blessing rented her a small shop and stocked it with everything she needed to get her business going again.
Now I tell people who believe in shamans that they don't work. I tell them they just need to follow Jesus. I want to say thank you to the 700 Club. The program has changed my life. May God bless you abundantly.
Thank you. If you're a 700 Club member, you are making Christ known throughout the nations of the earth, and it happens every day. There are medical outreaches going out in the name of Christ. Children are being educated. Homes are being found for orphans. You also are bringing the message through television programming in the language of the people who are watching it. We want to say thank you. You are making a huge difference in the lives of people just like you saw in that village in Nigeria. Be a part of that. If you're not a 700 Club member, it's such a simple process. You just call the toll-free number on your screen, 1-888-777-1999. Say, I want to join the 700 Club. What does that mean? Well, it's a commitment of 65 cents a day, $20 a month. You join with thousands of other people who are out to make a difference in the world, who want people to know the unconditional, amazing, miracle-working love of Jesus Christ. Be a part of that. Join with us today, 1-888-777-1999. Well, up next, a mom gets shocking news about her unborn baby.
Major heart defects, kidney problems, webbed necks where the neck actually comes out to here. And then she had told us that less than 1% will actually survive it.
Watch how this mom and dad made a life or death decision and see the miracle that follows.
If you're the mother of a child with behavior problems, I'd like to talk to you. My name is Janet Lehman, and I'm a behavioral therapist and a mom. I know what it's like when the child that you love becomes a defiant, out-of-control child who disrespects you.
That's why my husband James and I created the Total Transformation, the program that tens of thousands of moms are now using to turn around their child's behavior.
If you've heard about the Total Transformation and wondered if it will work for you, now you can try it for free. I'm willing to give away 1,000 programs today for free.
All you need to do is get the program and let us know how it works for you. We'll let you keep it for free.
I know the Total Transformation works because I used these techniques with my own son and with troubled kids for over 30 years. Let me prove to you that it works by giving you the program free.
Call the number on your screen now to get the Total Transformation free.
It's just sad. It's sad that in a matter of minutes, people can trash you and your business on the internet and get away with it. Did you know 9 out of 10 customers do an internet search before they buy? So when a former employee unfairly attacked you online, or an unhappy customer put you in a ripoff report, there was nothing you could do about it but watch your customers leave and your reputation suffer. Until now. Reputation.com gives you the power to protect yourself online. The internet can spin your life and job out of control, but Reputation.com watches over you online and improves your reputation by promoting the truth. Reputation.com protects everything you've worked so hard for, doing the things you just can't do yourself. Call now and get a free, detailed analysis of your online presence. Our reputation advisors will show you where the danger is and how much you have to risk.
Call 1-800-791-4911 for your free reputation review. That's 800-791-4911. Call now.
They're the words the couple in our next story long to hear. You're pregnant. But their child had a defective condition, and doctors said their only option was to terminate the baby.
I went for just a routine checkup with my doctor and had been having some kind of odd symptoms, so we ran some blood tests, and it was determined then that I was infertile. It was kind of sad. It was kind of hard to accept. Imagine our surprise in April 2009 when we discover that I am nearly 6 weeks pregnant. It was a big shock. By the time we went to our first ultrasound, which was at 11 weeks, we were really excited. We could not wait to see the little bean inside my belly. Then I noticed that the tech wasn't talking anymore. She'd become very quiet and not really responding to me, and she excused herself and left the room, and she came back in with a doctor who just looked at the screen and nodded her head, and she explained that we had a 6-millimeter cystic hygroma, which is a fluid-filled sac on the back of the neck. And it's almost always a red flag indicator of a genetic disorder of some sort. She kept going back to the Turner syndrome. She seemed to feel that it was more likely to be that and gave us some information, some printed information. We went on to meet with the genetic counselor who then explained it to us. With Turner syndrome, there's many manifestations that can happen with it. Heart defects, major heart defects that require open heart surgeries, and kidney problems where they're either missing a kidney or they have misshaped kidneys. Webbed necks, where the neck actually comes out to here because of the hygroma that had stretched the skin in the womb. And then she had told us that less than 1% will actually survive it. And that's when she said, you really need to consider abortion because your baby will not survive. If you don't abort, then you can expect a miscarry in the next couple of weeks.
Sitting in that office listening to a doctor say, you're not going to have this child. You're probably going to lose this child. A little bit of depression set in there. Fear. Fear was the biggest. Not knowing, you know, what's going on. And can we deal with a child if she does make it?
But if you wait and you don't abort and she doesn't miscarry right away, then you're going to have to go another route because it'll be too late to abort. So make your decision, don't dwell on it, and just move on.
We were not really given much hope, and actually we were sent home to make a decision, basically when to abort.
Immediately came home and locked myself in the bedroom and grabbed my laptop, and everything I found was horrible.
I went outside and I prayed about it, and I thought, no, I would like to give God the opportunity to shine here. So I went back in and I said, Monica, let's put that stuff away, let's go to church.
I told him, okay, you're right. We need to go to church, and that is the one place I can go fall apart and it's safe and it's okay. Went down to church and spoke with the minister. And the pastor said, do you mind if we lay hands on you? And that was very different for us. And the entire congregation came forward and laid hands on us. It was so touching that every single person, I mean, they really, this wasn't an act. They really meant it. They really felt it. And they prayed for healing.
The entire church came together for us. Which to me was the deciding factor.
Shortly after, I went and sat back down in my seat so they could begin service. And that's when I felt something happening in the womb that I knew was unexplainable. When you're 11 weeks pregnant, you can't feel a thing. You don't feel the baby moving. But I was feeling the equivalent of a 10-pound baby in my belly flipping around. It was a very strong feeling. Like a ball of energy in my stomach, and it tickled tremendously. I knew God was touching me at that moment. He was touching that baby. He had just reached into my womb and had, whatever was wrong that was going to be a problem was no longer going to be a problem. It was fixed. We fired the clinic that we initially went to and decided to find a new doctor affiliated with a new hospital that would be more positive. Went in for the 16-week ultrasound, and they discovered that the cystic hygroma was completely gone. There was no evidence it had ever been there. And we went for 23 weeks. They decided they needed to do an echocardiogram. So they checked her heart, and they were looking so hard to find what they were expecting to see, which was coarctation of the aorta. The aorta actually narrows. And that's a major problem for babies with Turner's that requires multiple surgeries if they survive it. They kept looking, and they had me come back 3 times. And each time they would spend 2 hours looking for this problem. And finally they said, oh, it's not there. And I said, well, of course it's not there. But that's okay. You can keep looking.
And we just really delighted in watching these doctors scratch their head. It was a fun experience.
And then finally the day came that we went into labor.
Monica had a cesarean. They delivered Ellie. And of course they rush her over and do their thing with her, and they wrapped her up and handed her to me. And at that point, it really sunk in with me that she's here and that she's real and that she is okay.
And she was beautiful and healthy.
I looked into her eyes. And I knew she was God sent. I knew she had a purpose. And we had a new addition to our family.
Nearly 100% of women diagnosed just with the cystic hygroma before it's even known if it's Down syndrome or Turner syndrome.
To look her over and see that she had all her fingers and all her toes. And
nearly 100% of women are advised to abort. Just go ahead and abort.
And she was screaming and she was alive.
And that's what I'm seeing week after week on the support forums, is I've been told to abort. So I try to explain to them that there is more hope than that.
I had the experience of seeing this live child.
That they don't have to abort, and share with them our story.
Where 9 months before we were told she would not live. Praise God.
Praise God for life. He's given us all life and breath. And he wants to take care of us. He wants to be our God and for us to be his people. He calls us his friends. Start understanding just how immense that is. What a wonderful thing that God reaches down from heaven to answer our prayers. Now, let me encourage you with a couple of verses. One is, the Israelites were slaves in Egypt. They were being treated brutally. Their children were subject to death by their Egyptian masters. What does God tell Moses? I see, I hear, I understand. Realize that before you even come to him in prayer, that he sees, he hears. And yes, indeed, he understands. He understands and wants to help. He wants to be your very present help in time of need. Now, in an act of faith, just lay your hand on that area of the body that needs healing. And just say, Lord, I know that you see this, that you hear my prayer, that you understand my need. And then Terry and I are going to agree, and we're going to claim this great verse, when two or more agree touching anything, it shall be done. There are no options here. There shall be done. So we're going to agree, and we're going to join with you as you lay that hand on that area of the body that needs healing. And we're just going to believe, not going to make it complicated. Just be like little children. We're going to come to Daddy, and we're going to believe. And let him do all the rest. Let's pray. Lord, we lift the needs to you right now. And as people are laying hands on that area of the body that needs healing, we join with them in agreement. And together we reach out and touch. And we say out loud, be healed and be made whole. From the top of your head to the soles of your feet, let everything come into alignment. Let every cell in your body be at peace and be made whole now in Jesus' name. There's someone laying your hand on the right side of the back of your neck, and there's pain that goes all the way from the back of your ear down into your shoulder. God's just releasing all of that. He's able to just to relax every muscle, bring every bone in your neck into alignment. He's able to restore everything. You just felt that peace wash through you. God's healing you now in Jesus' name. Tara?
There's somebody else. You have a chronic condition. You've had it for a really, really long time. And the thing that I see is just a long, long tunnel that you've been in. But God has your back. You are about to come out of that. You're going to experience wholeness, healing, wellness. That was a dark tunnel, very difficult place for you to be for all of this time. It's been years. Expect that healing now in Jesus' name.
There's a woman named Mary. You're crying out for healing for recurring sinus infections. You're experiencing pain, deep pain now just from them. In Jesus' name, be healed and be made whole. If you've been touched by God, we want to share in your good report, so give us a call. We leave with this word from John, my sheep listen to my voice. I know them, and they follow me. God bless you.